As God has blessed us in so many ways, let's share our offering with God now. Sideline, and I'm going to invite Kathy VandenBeuvel to share our reading before our children time this morning. So Pete, can you go to that slide, and hopefully we will have everything corrected in just a couple of minutes.
The first scripture reading is Psalm 139. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book, before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. If only you, God, would slay the wicked. Away from me, you who are bloodthirsty. They speak of you with evil intent. Your adversaries misuse your name. Do I not hate those who hate you, Lord, and abhor those who are in rebellion against you? I have nothing but hatred for them. I count them my enemies. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. The second scripture reading is from John chapter 20, verses 19 to 29. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Jesus appears to Thomas. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed."
Thank you.
time, the work you need. Okay, so I think we have one children. Hunter, would you like to come forward? I'm going to show you a picture of somebody. I don't know if you recognize her. So first click, please, Pete. Do you recognize that person at all? No? Okay. Next slide. How about next slide? No? Okay, anybody?
No? Roberta Bondar.
That's Dr. Roberta Bondar. And she was the first Canadian woman to go into space. And you'll notice that in the first slide, looks like she's wearing a sweater. And in the next two slides, she's wearing her uniform. So what does a uniform do for her? What does a spacesuit do for her? Gives her oxygen, what else? Keeps her warm. Keeps her warm because it's very cold in space. So it protects her, right? But let me ask you this. Does the uniform, or does the spacesuit make her any better? Still just who she is, right? Okay, now, next slide, please. Okay, first click. Anybody recognize him?
No.
No. I was hoping. What's that? What's that? That's right, Marcus Estrada. Only one of the top relievers in the Toronto Blue Jays this year, from what I understand. So what's he wearing there? His Blue Jay uniform. And what about in this picture? What's he wearing there? A suit. Same guy. But does the suit makes him look nice, doesn't it? And does the uniform make him play any better? No. So it's just him, right? And just like Dr. Roberta Bondar. What about me? I got a jacket on today and all these folks. Or you? Do your clothes make you any better? No. It's who you are inside, right? No matter what you wear, no matter what you look like, God loves you and uses you just the way you are. So is that a good thing? That's a pretty good thing. Okay, so let's pray about that. And let's pray together. God, we thank you.
God, we thank you.
For uniforms.
For uniforms.
That set us apart.
That set us apart.
And for spacesuits.
And for spacesuits.
That protect us.
That protect us.
But mostly.
But mostly.
We thank you for making us.
We thank you for making us.
Just the way we are.
Just the way we are.
And that's good enough.
And that's good enough.
For you.
For you.
So help us understand.
So help us understand
that who somebody is,
that who somebody is,
should be good enough for us.
Should be good enough for us.
Amen.
Amen.
So I think Brian has some work for you. Hello. Let's bow our heads together in prayer. Loving God, we come before you this morning in humility. After having heard David's words and the way he reminds us that you know us full well, we realize that in many ways we come here unworthy. We come knowing that our hearts are not always fully here or fully in your presence. And yet we know that you accept us anyway, that you receive us just the way we are. And so we praise you, however limited that praise might be, for your wisdom and power. We praise you for the order that you bring to creation, and for the beauty that delights body, mind, and soul. But as we praise you, we acknowledge that we would not be here without you. We are dependent upon your kindness and mercy, your truth, your justice, in order to set our hearts straight and to put our minds at peace. And now we seek the mercy and grace through the gift of the cross, the sacrifice that paid for our sins. Forgiveness in a world that allows terror acts like those in France. Forgiveness for a world that allows things like child prostitution in Toronto, that allows the pollution that threatens our environment and sullies the earth's beauty, that allows the rich to rule over the poor and injustice to reign throughout the world, that allows for our own personal sins that we confess now. God, we have confessed our sin and we seek your forgiveness. And as we seek your forgiveness, we give you thanks for that gift of the cross, for our church, for the good people within it, for the time, the talent, and treasures that we have to bless our lives and to bless those around us, for the community in which we are allowed to serve, for the Holy Spirit that empowers us, and for Jesus who models life for us. In his name we pray. Amen. Now we're going to sing. Thank you. Well, friends, if somebody like me is going to make a royal mess of things, it's good that we do it on a day like today, when we're talking about the way the Lord accepts us just as we are. I had plans for today that were a lot smoother, but I think we're on track again. So first slide, please. Pete, anybody recognize this gentleman here?
Homer.
One of my heroes, Homer Simpson, from the Simpsons, the eponymous show about him. And Homer is well-intentioned, but he tends to get himself into situations that are challenging and difficult. However, let me tell you this about Homer. Over the 28 seasons that the show has been on the air, Homer has never once been unfaithful to his wife. They have one of the strongest marriages on TV and maybe in the world, which is a sad thing to say, but you know, they've been married for over, well, they were married before the series began, and somehow they still have an 8-year-old daughter and a 10-year-old boy. But Homer Simpson is one of those folks that clearly we accept just the way he is, right? Now, did you know that Homer Simpson was roughly based on this next character, please, Peter? Did you know that? Did you recognize Archie Bunker from All in the Family? He's Carol O'Connor, that's right. He's roughly a parody of this gentleman, and you full well know that Carol O'Connor, or Archie Bunker, as he was known in the series, was cantankerous, shall we say, prejudiced, difficult to live with, and yet we accepted him just the way he was. And his character came roughly from this one. We're going back in time here. This is the Wayback Machine. Fred Flintstone, right? And of course, again, you know, a character who always meant well and yet always got themselves into these crazy situations. And throughout the number of years, I think it was only about 6 years, but it made a lasting impression that the series was on. But he remained faithful to his wife and his friends, and we accepted him just the way he was. And one of the archetypes, let's go way back now, let's test your knowledge. No, not doctor. Father knows best. That's, yeah, that's right. name slips my mind.
Robert Young,
that's right. I was thinking Robert Wells, but Robert Young, you're right. So Robert Young in Father Knows Best. And of course, he played the archetypical klutzy dad who always, this comes up again, always got himself into these embarrassing situations. And somehow he always managed to live up to the acceptance of his wife and his kids. So we accept him just the way we are. So there's a theme here, isn't there, of acceptance, of understanding. And we begin in earnest with this idea through God. Go to the first slide, please. This is David. Okay, King David wrote this beautiful psalm, Psalm 139, that talks about how God understands him. And he says, "How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them, were I to count them. They would outnumber the grains of sand. When I am awake, I am still with you." And so he puts himself into God's hands. He acknowledges that God shaped him and formed him, and he knows him intimately, and he loves him despite the fact that he made some very stupid moves, especially with Bathsheba and Uriah the Hittite. If you remember that story, he fell in love with another woman's wife, and in order to make her his own, he had her husband accidentally put at the front of a battle where he was killed by the opposing forces. But of course, it was just an accident. I mean, how did David know that if you put one man in front of a well-trained army and then have all his soldiers retreat, and you leave that one man in front of a well-trained army, how did he know that that one man would get killed? And yet, God kept him as the king. And we use him as a model, and so we got this wonderful, where'd my papers go? Who's this paper? Got this wonderful words. And then he says, go to the next slide, look at this. Then he says, when I'm awake, I am still with you. Isn't that nice? And then he says, if only you, God, would slay the wicked away from me, you who are bloodthirsty. They speak of you with evil intent. Go on. Your adversaries misuse your name. Do I not hate those who hate you, Lord? I abhor those who are in rebellion against you. I have nothing but hatred for them. I count them my enemies. And then, search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. It's almost as if an editor came in and threw in this text against his enemies, right? The entire length of the poem is this beautiful praise of how God made him. And then David either loses his mind and suddenly just can't hold it in and says, you know how good I am, David, or how good I am, God. I'm so good that I hate your enemies too. Or an editor said, well, you know what, this is a little serious, threw in this text. But one way or another, it's kind of a bizarre jump, isn't it? Kind of a strange way to write your praises of God, to suddenly change this tone and then change it again. Search me, God, and know my heart. And yet, what did we say about Homer and Archie and Fred Flintstone and Robert Young? Father knows best. God accepts them just the way they were, right? It's just the way it is. God created us, knows us, and loves us even though we were made perfectly, but we mess up anyway. Next slide, please, Pete. Here's another story of acceptance. Jesus, after his crucifixion and resurrection, makes appearances to different people. Today, Kathy read to us about his appearance to the 12. So he comes to them and he says, peace be with you, Father. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And he breathed on them and said, next slide, please. Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. So he gives his disciples this encouragement. He seems to give them a little assignment, but he reveals himself to the disciples. He shows them his wounds, and they believe. They buy into it. They realize that the Savior is there, that Jesus is not dead, that he's come back to life. What a gift it was, right, for them to recognize that Jesus, despite the appearance of loss, had actually won the war, let alone the battle. But poor Thomas, Thomas was off making sure that the supplies were ready. Thomas was praying in the temple. Thomas was mending the nets so they could go. We don't know where Thomas was. Thomas wasn't there. So he didn't get to see Jesus. But Jesus, in his grace and mercy, when Thomas was there, he came back. And Thomas had complained, I didn't get to see Jesus. I want to see Jesus too. So Jesus returned to him. And Thomas asked, well, I'm not going to believe unless I get to see the wounds too. So Jesus revealed the wounds to him. And then Jesus says, you believe because you saw me. Blessed are those who believe even though they haven't seen me. But you see, Jesus accepted Thomas where he was. Understood that Thomas needed to see the physical evidence, despite the fact that his friends had told him what had happened, that they were reliable witnesses. I mean, Thomas had been with them for a while. But Thomas needed this extra little bit of example, and so Jesus granted it to him. No problem, it's okay. But Jesus also blessed those of us who follow Thomas, who follow the disciples, who didn't get to see Jesus in person. So what happened was the disciples were given the Holy Spirit, were given this gift, and it might not have happened to Thomas the same way, but the idea is that it's up to us to reveal Jesus alive in the world. So we have this assignment. We have this task that we're doing. And I'm going to posit, I'm going to suggest that maybe we haven't been doing such a good job of it in our world. We all lament that the Christian church has been having a difficult time, that it's shrinking. And part of that, I think, comes from the fact that we have a hard time talking about Jesus. One of the things that is identified, next slide please, Pete. Oh, sorry, keep going. I'm too far. There we go. I'm going to change the order up a little bit. Sorry, Pete. One of the things that's been identified as a need for any congregation, for any person to thrive and survive and to be able to grow, is this idea of a passionate spirituality. This idea where we express our spirituality. And here's how it comes out. First slide. First point. It means that we're enthusiastic about our spiritual life. And that means that we take an active part in prayer, in reading scripture, in being involved in our churches and in the life of our friends, family, and community. Not just doing stuff, but with God in the forefront. We had a very telling meeting the other day with our board and our session, because we were just a little bit worried about our financial situation. And part of the meeting, I invited folks to share what mattered about St. James. And almost to a person, of the 20 folks that were gathered, almost to a man, they said, we love the friendship and fellowship. We love the family feeling of this church, which is a wonderful thing. But one of the outside observers, one of the visitation team, one of the people supporting us said, you know, it's great that you got this family feeling, but I hardly heard God mentioned. That's something to think about. That it's when we put, we love our family because God has put us here, or God gave us this great family. That's the difference. That's being enthusiastic about the spiritual life. Next point. Means that we also grow spiritually. How many of you remember your Sunday school lessons? Remember them? But how many of you have ever thought, you know, maybe I should do some Sunday school or some teaching and learning now as an adult? Sometimes we get stuck at our Sunday school level and we figure, well, that's a good place to be, which is pretty good because we learn some basic values. But part of our challenge as people of faith is to grow in our spirituality. Next point, please. Practicing our faith with joy. Here's one where we Presbyterians are joyful about feeding other people and meeting with friends. And, you know, some of us are joyful about going to the hospital and doing visitation. There's quite a bit of, where'd Bruce go? There, sorry. There's quite a bit of joy around the refugee family, and I think being part of that team and seeing the response made you a little bit happy, to be honest. So, you know, there's practicing our faith with joy, but sometimes we forget to insert the fact that it's God and the Holy Spirit that's inspiring us to do it. Final point. Sharing our faith with others. This is where we Presbyterians, we're called the Frozen Chosen for a reason, right? We're called the Frozen Chosen because we hesitate to talk about our faith with others. We hesitate to mention the G word in public. Well, Pete, I'm going to invite you to go back a couple of slides. One more. I think that's the one. Yeah, stay there for a second. Here's what I want you to think about. When we heard the story read by Kathy, we pass over an important part in that story. Often it gets ignored. We're so busy talking about Thomas, we ignore this part of the story. On the evening of that first day of the week when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders. Next slide. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for. So you see, the problem here is that the disciples were in a locked room, isolated from the rest of the world. They were afraid of what was going on, and because they were afraid of what was going on, they shut themselves on, and Jesus had to enter supernaturally. Jesus didn't enter through the door, through the window, through the roof, through the floor. Jesus entered somehow supernaturally into this room. And I think that sometimes we as people of faith are so happy to be a community, so happy to have our family, that what ends up happening is we almost lock our doors, not to other people coming in. I mean, we're great. We really are a good church at welcoming others and making them feel part of the family. But it's that spiritual door that's locked. It's that element of faith that we lock. So on the evening of that first day of the week, we could write, when we are gathered together, the doors are locked for, well, you know, people don't want to hear about God. Well, it's hard for me to talk about God. Well, I don't think about what I do at church in those terms. Well, the last time I thought about the Holy Spirit was at Pentecost when we sang this really great song that mentioned the Holy Spirit 22 times, and I thought, oh my gosh, is this song ever going to end? So we have this idea of almost being a club. We come here to do nice things, say hi to our family, to be friendly, to be loving, to do all of those things, but we forget, as one person put it, the vertical component, the spiritual end of it. Next slide, please. On the evening of that first day of the week when the disciples were together with our hearts locked, we put God in there, we take our Sunday school lessons, we take what I say, we put them safely away there, but we forget to share them beyond. We forget that a vital part of what we do, the chicken dinner this evening, right? That's a spiritual thing. Feeding people is a gift from God. The fact that we have that restaurant that we can get to cater for us, the fact that we have this beautiful place to welcome folks, the fact that we have welcoming hearts and we're willing to do the work. These are spiritual gifts. But when we don't share that credit, when we don't pass it along, I honestly think God says, well, you guys are doing great. You guys are doing wonderful. You don't need me. Carry on. But when we don't depend on God, when we forget about that spiritual component, that's when we get into trouble. So here's the challenge that I want you to think about. Here's how I want you to understand this idea of passion and spirituality. How many of you so love the Blue Jays or the Tigers or the Rangers or Michael Schumacher that you can identify the players on the team, and you'll get into passionate discussions between the difference between the NFL and the AFL, or the Major League East and West, or the difference, you know, why soccer is better than American football. You talk passionately about those things, right? How many of you can identify every band that you've ever heard in concert and all of the players, and have a stack of vinyl two rooms long, and you know every word to the songs and maybe all the chords, and you'll argue why the Beatles are not as good as the Rolling Stones, right? And you do that with passion and excitement. How many of you, if you've got kids or grandkids, are only too willing to pull out the entire photo album that you happen to have stored in your wallet, or nowadays on your iPad or on your phone, right? You know you're in trouble when somebody comes up to you with their phone and says, "Oh, just look at this picture of my granddaughter at soccer, at baseball, at hockey, at school, getting this graduation award. Here she is at her first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, eighth birthday. Here she is at the dance," right? You know you're in trouble. You're going to miss the appointment. So if we can talk with such passion about sports or music or our kids or our jobs, why can't we do that about our church, about our God, about our Savior? Our spirituality, our faith should be the number one component. Because David recognized it wasn't the Toronto Blue Jays that set us into place. It wasn't the Rolling Stones or the Beatles who gave us the heart to she loved to know that she loves me, yeah, 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 and you can't buy love. It was God who gave us this church, this family, these gifts that we have. And it's God that we need to be as passionate about if we want not just our church, but our faith, but Christianity itself, and even our world to thrive and survive. God accepts you just the way you are, and you're wonderfully and beautifully made. Why don't we accept God just the way God is, beautifully and wonderfully indefinable, and yet the source of our life? Why aren't we as passionate about God as God is about us? Amen. Let's pray. God, David was not perfect. Thomas had less than stellar moments. The other disciples weren't much better. And we're a lot like David, Thomas, or any other human being. But even in our imperfection, even in our weakness and our doubts, you accept us just the way we are. You work on us through your Holy Spirit. You send us mentors and guides to show us the way. You have offered us your word of Scripture to teach us. You've given us Jesus himself to point us in the direction we should go and to show us how to do what we need to do. So you don't change us into anything different. You make us new and fresh and as perfect as we can be. And that's just the way you want us to be. God, in all of this, we realize that you're passionate about us, that you don't hold anything back from us. But in turn, we realize that we aren't always as passionate towards you, towards your Holy Spirit, or even towards Jesus. like the disciples hiding away in a locked room. We hide our faith from others in fear of embarrassment, or because we don't think we have the right words, or because we have other things on our minds. But we realize, God, we confess, God, that our lack of passion has cost us dearly. Our congregation, our church, Christianity is struggling because we Christians have not been as passionate about you as you are about us. It's a hard thing to admit. It's a hard thing to say that our lack of passion has cost us dearly, to face up to the fact that we can't blame society for our struggles because we Christians have become more passionate about society than we are about our faith, or about serving others in love, or for taking care of our neighbors, or sharing the good news that you revealed to us through Jesus. So we're saying it now, we're owning up to it now, and we're trying to do better. We realize that it's going to take work. We know that it's going to be hard to build up our passion, to truly love the way Jesus loves us, to care for our community the way you care for all creation, and to trust your Holy Spirit the way we trust our friends in the pews. We realize that we struggle financially, and that those financial struggles are immediate and frightening. But we also realize that if we trust you and burn the passion of the Holy Spirit fire within us, you will help us to get beyond our worries, to achieve the financial stability and strength we need, so that we can continue to serve as your church within this community. Help us, God. Help us to be as passionate for you as you are for us. Help us to be a living presence in our community that reveals Jesus alive. Help us to give our talents, time, and treasures as freely as you have provided them. And help us to thrive and to grow and to make new disciples, just as Jesus called us to. For it is in his name we pray. Amen. And please rise for our benediction and final song. May God give you for every storm a rainbow, for every tear a smile, for every care a promise and a blessing in every trial, for every problem life sends a faithful friend to share, for every sigh a sweet song and an answer for every prayer. And together we say, Amen.